So in the till now, whatever we have studied is that in this digital source, why I'm revising again and again, because you need to remember this can come as MCQ question. So how we have converted, earlier the signal that we have got was analog signal. We have converted analog signal into digital signal with the help of the techniques that we are having is PAM, PWM, PPM, right? After that, we have converted into source encoder with the help of PCM, pulse code modulation. What we have done when we are converting to convert analog signal into digital signal, we did sampling. Okay. So in sampling, what we have done, we have successive time periods we have been decided depending upon what speed we are going to send the data. Everything is interrelated with each other. Based on that, we have done the sampling. After the sampling is done, now the data that we have got is in the form of pulses. Now these pulses that we have got, we need to give a voltage level to it that we have done with the help of quantization. Now, to improve the quality of reconstruction of our signal at demodulator, we have increased the quantization level and that improves the quality of your signal. Now, after we have done that with the in-source encoder, we have converted into codes, right? Now, after giving into codes, now our data is in digital format in terms of ones and zeros. Okay. So now what we have seen, that entire analog signal is converted into digital signal and they are converted into codes. Now these codes, depending upon which channel we are using, we are sending these codes with the starting and ending of our signal and which channel we are going to send. Basically, we are giving an address to the codes that we are having. Now in modulator, we have seen what we have done. These digital data that we have got, we are sending it through a channel. Now, what has happened in the modulator? A modulation has happened. What are the techniques we are using in this modulator? We are using ASK, FSK, PSK, combination of ASK, PSK, or combination of FSK and ASK, and vice versa. So we are combining all these techniques so that now data is ready to be transmitted. Now, when the data is getting transmitted, we are sending through the channel. Now here, now what we are going to discuss next is about the channel. So in channel, basically the channel is a transmission media which we are going to go send the data. Now we can use any type of media depending upon how much data are we sending. Now, if you are talking about telephone lines, internets, they are mostly we are using guided media. And if you are talking about satellite transmission, it becomes an unguided media. So in guided media, you can use coaxial cable, fiber optic, twisted cables also. Now, coaxial cables and twisted cables are actually taking the data in a form of electric pulses, whereas in fiber optic, it has been sent in the form of a light. So you will mostly find in submarines or where the long distance transmission is happening, like say between two countries where an ocean is in between. So there the transmission happens through fiber optic. And especially we are talking about in terms of internet. And when it is nearby distances, we mostly follow the coaxial and twisted. Now, you know also about the baseband and broadband. Now, these, remember, you never restrict yourself to either guided or unguided. It's mostly combination of both. Sometimes, like you talk about LAN, we are having systems. We are having internet. We are having Ethernet. But still, even if the Wi-Fi is there, you need wires to connect your router with the one particular system. So like this is a combination of both guided and unguided media when we talk about the channel or we talk about transmission media. Now baseband, you know what it is? Baseband is basically when you are going ahead a simple signal which has not been modulated and it can be sent directly through ground waves or through wires. Broadband is basically when we use the modulation and that means the baseband signal has been superimposed onto the high frequency signal and then it's sent in a various ways. So we call it as a broadband transmission. Shielded and unshielded is basically when you talk about the way the wires are being covered to protect them from any kind of interference from the atmosphere or because of the components developed around it. So like this, different transmission media are being used based on at which surrounding we are sending data, how far we are sending data, and what type of data is being sent, transmitted, and what bandwidth we are using. Now, mostly when you talk about the transmission, we mostly use the term radio frequency. Now here you can see the radio frequency is a very wide range. It can go from 3 kilohertz to 300 gigahertz, and every part of this radio frequency is used for different type of applications. Like you can see that if you go for astronomy or radio or satellite communication, you can see the frequency we are using is very, very high. That is close to 300 gigahertz. Whereas when you talk about navigation, the frequency that we are using is like 3 kilohertz to 30 kilohertz or 300 kilohertz. So the frequency range, depending upon what application we are going to use, we are going to use high or medium or low frequencies. Now, when you talk about digital radio, this digital radio is basically, we are sending our signals in terms of pulses. That is in terms of digits, in terms of ones and zeros. So same FM signal that we are having, we have digitalized it. We are using digital communication for it and now sending into the space with the help of analog carrier. Now this carrier will again superimpose, but right now, remember, we are using all those techniques that we have studied, ASK, PSK, FSK, and combination to send this data. So the advantage that we get is the clarity is good, the transmission and reception is good, the noise which captured, which has been superimposed onto the signals can be easily removed because the signal is in terms of pulses. Now, if you see the difference between frequency modulation and digital radio frequency modulation, here what we are basically happening, the advantages and disadvantage of this FM is basically the wavelength, or I should say, talk about the bandwidth. The bandwidth is required for FM as compared to radio frequency is less, because here what is happening, we are converting the signal into pulses and then we are sending. So naturally the bandwidth required by digital radio frequency is higher as compared to FM. If you compare both of them, there is not much difference. The only difference is frequency modulation is purely analog, whereas digital modulation here, we have converted into bits and then we are sending. So the advantage that we get here is even if it takes the bandwidth, more bandwidth, the quality of our reception is better as compared to FM. So depending upon the application, we use sometimes FM and sometimes this digital radio frequency. Now, the advantages and disadvantages of digital transmission is, if you talk about advantages, we know that signal regeneration is very good because it's easy for us to remove the noise from the received signal. Then time division multiplexing is better. Why? Because based on, as we have seen when we are talking about ASK, FSK, PSK, you can make it ASK, that is quadrature. Or you can talk about PSK, QPSK, you can make it QFSK, you can make it. That means just by changing the amplitude of various carrier or various frequencies by using various frequencies, or by just changing a phase from 0 degree to 30 degree or 60 degree to 90 degree, we are able to send multiple signals at a time. That means time division multiplexing is happening where the range remains the same, but we are able to send multiple datas because each data, say if you take the example of hello, H goes in say 0 degree phase shift, E goes with 30 degree phase shift, L goes with say 60 degree phase shift. So the color, when it is received, H will be received very clearly, E will be received very clearly, L will be received very clearly. Why? Because they are not intermingling with each other. So we call such kind of this time division multiplexing that we'll be seeing again later. Now the disadvantage that we have, since we are giving so many time division multiplexing we are using, one disadvantage that adds is that the bandwidth is increasing and increasing, because as many type multi-time TDM you do it, that much bandwidth will increase. And synchronization between the transmitter and receiver is very much necessary, because if there is a mismatch, then naturally when you are viewing some kind of video, audio will come separately and visual will come separately. There will be a time lag between them. So the synchronization between transmitter and receiver needs to be good. Then multiplexing difficulties, yes. Since we know we are converting analog into digital, then doing the entire processing, again converting digital into analog, we are using multiple frequencies, multiple phase, multiple amplitudes. So multiplexing becomes difficult because we are trying to fit in so many things in that particular bandwidth. Then, the same thing that we said, the compatibility with the analog facilities is difficult because you're converting from one form to another form. But if you see the advantages as compared to disadvantages, advantages are higher. So we just work onto the disadvantage and focus onto the advantages. So we prefer to go with the digital transmission. Now, there are some factors that we have studied earlier in the unit that maximum data rate needs to be taken care. Remember, we have studied about the Nyquist criteria. Now, this Nyquist criteria is very important because when we are sending data or we are modulating or when we are receiving, we have to see our aim is that when we are reconstructing this data, what has been sent, it should come very close to what has been sent so that the data that has been sent is been implemented with sampling and quantization, and that what we are calling is Nyquist criteria, with the condition that the sampling rate should be higher than the bit rate that we are having or bandwidth that we are having. Why? The reason is only when the sampling is higher, then only when we are reconstructing, we are getting a better result. We all know what is sampling. It's just like we are giving a graph. As fine the graph will be, that better the reconstruction of the signal will be. Or as fine the graph will be, that nice, that the quality of the result or the quality of the picture will be better, right? So that's what we are talking about when we say that sampling rate should be higher. That condition needs to be taken. See, noise is one factor, but when we are sending at that time, at least we should send in a good condition. We are talking about that. So at the transmitter end, the sampling has been done with the help of Nyquist criteria so that when it is reconstructed at the receiver, that time the reconstruction is efficient and of good quality. Then there are some more terms that will be used that needs to be taken care of when we are talking about data transmission and when we are talking about channel characteristics. As we said, channel noise. Now, channel itself should not add noise to the signal because, see, if you take about simple transmission medium, if you say, we have already studied when the long transmission wire line is there, automatically a resistance is developed, a capacitance is developed, inductance is developed, conductance is developed. Now these themselves should not add noise to the signal. Otherwise, what will happen if the channel is noisy, then the data that has been flowing through it will automatically get a lot of noise into it, right? So that has to be taken care. So signal to noise ratio should be good. Then comes channel bandwidth. We cannot stuff a lot of data in a particular bandwidth, right? We need to see to it that when reconstruction is happening, our data loss is not happening. So channel bandwidth needs to be taken care, and that is done with the respect of, so based on that only the sampling has been done. Then comes our channel data transmission rate. Now this channel data transmission rate is a bit rate that we are talking, that maximum number of bits that can transmit through this media. That is what we said. We don't want to stuff our bandwidth with lot of data. So how much data should go, that has been, and what should be the speed of it is being taken care by this bit rate. That also needs to be seen when we are deciding about the how much data we have to send. Then come channel utilization. We don't want that half of our channel should be empty. We want to use it in an effective way. Same thing will come. The bandwidth of that channel should be utilized in such a way that loss of data is also not happening. Efficiently, entire data has been passed through it. So we are calling it as a channel utilization. So these are a few things that need to see when we are talking about characteristics. Some more characteristics we need to see. First is bandwidth requirement. Just now we have seen why is it important. Then speed. Yes. What speed? Which bit rate it is going? We will call it as speed. Then we have just now seen that noise should not get added in the channel by the channel itself. Then this baud rate, crosstalk, distortion, and equalizers and echo compressors. This will be taking it in further. So if you talk about bandwidth requirement, we just now saw that bandwidth, we don't want to stuff our channel with a lot of data. We want it to go in such a way that reconstructions become easy. Now here, if you see, the type of modulation you have used is basically going to decide how much data it's been consumed. We know ASK is amplitude related. So naturally, the data that will pass through it will not take much bandwidth. But if you talk about FSK, since a lot of frequencies are involved in it, the bandwidth required will be higher. So depending upon how much data you are sending, how much data rate is there, the depending upon the capacity of channel, the bandwidth needs to be taken care of. Now, simple example, if we take, that is a drawback that we have seen if we compare analog and digital, that if you compare analog, comparatively, digital takes more bandwidth with respect to analog. The only advantage why we are ignoring or we are working only onto the drawbacks and focusing more onto the advantages of bandwidth is that it's easy for us to regenerate pulses and to remove distortions that have added up to it. So that is the basic reason, because that improves the quality of your signal. So we prefer to go with it. Next, we have baud rate and bit rate. What is a bit rate? Bit rate is basically how many bits can be sent per second. How many bits are passing through per second? We are calling it as bit rate. And what is a baud rate? Baud rate is number of times the changes has happened. That means if the data is continuously going from 00, then 00, 00, then remember we are talking in terms of bit, but the way the transition is happening from 00 to 01, 11 to 10. So these changes, when we talk about, we call it as a baud rate. Baud rate plays a very important role, because every time the changes happen from 0 to 1, possibility of noise getting added is also there. But as we know, we have the advantage of taking our digital data and we can remove the noise. So this shift from one set of bits to another set of bits is called as baud rate, and it has to be taken care when we talk in terms of transmission channel. Then signaling speed, we know that at fast the data moves on, that many times this baud rate will happen, that many times the bandwidth required will be more, because as fast is the data, that wide bandwidth will be required, because it has to accommodate the lot of data into it. So that is one factor. Second thing is that when you're focusing on to the, remember we are talking only terms of channel right now. So in the system, when the the data, when it has been encoded and sent, and if the transmission bit is very fast, then naturally it will exceed the baud rate. So that part has to be also taken care when we are planning about what should be the speed of our data in the channel. Next, noise factor. We know how noise has affected. We know it's always easy to remove noise from the digital data. As we know that noise always affects the higher frequency and the amplitudes. So if it affects on amplitude, then just by using the filter, we can just eliminate the noise and we can recover the better quality data. Then next, we will discuss in the next class.